Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to start the commission meeting February the 20th. We're going to have the invocation by the chaplain for the Ocoee Police Department, David Hartsburg. And the Pledge of Allegiance by Commissioner Furstner, and then we'll have the roll call. Please stand.
Please bow with me. Holy Father in heaven, we come to you thanking you for your blessings upon this great nation. But also, Father, we have sorrow in our hearts over the recent tragedy in South Florida. We pray your blessings upon those that are grieving over the loss of loved ones and the ones that have been injured in so many ways. My Father, we pray for a healing for our nation, that we might be more civil one to another, that brotherly love might grow and grow, that these things would not be a part of our lives. We pray, Father, that we might do all that we can individually and collectively as your people to share your love and to reach out to those who are hurting in so many different ways. Father, we pray for our leaders from the local to the top of the nation, that your will would be done, that we might be able to be a nation at peace and at love one with another and be able to enjoy our freedoms. We pray, Father, that we may disagree on many things, but let us not be bitter enemies one with another over these things that will pass. My Father, we pray that you bless those of this meeting this night who are going to be making decisions for our city. We pray that you endue them with wisdom. We thank you for the progress that is being made in this city and for all the things that are happening in a positive way. Bless all of our first responders and our military and all who selflessly give of themselves for our benefit. Bless us all. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Commissioner Grogan?
Here.
Commissioner Wilson?
Here.
Mayor Johnson?
Here.
Commissioner Furstner?
Here.
Commissioner Keller?
Here.
All right, we have a presentations and proclamations. We'll start off with a presentation of a check by Assistant Director of Parks and Recreation, Mark Johnson, to Saving Young Hearts as the beneficiary of the proceeds from the Chick-fil-A 5K run and Kids Fun Run during Founders Day.
Good evening, Commissioner, Mayor, City Manager. We're here tonight to present the check for the beneficiary of the Chick-fil-A 5K for last year's Founders Day. So I'm gonna call Beth Ott down from Chick-fil-A. Give her the floor.
Hello. Good evening, everyone. Dr. Fravel, Mrs. Fravel, you can come join me. They do the Kids Fun Run for us every year. And Martha, is she in? Oh, right here. Come on up. Martha Lopez Anderson, the benefactor with Saving Young Hearts. And, of course, we have the Chick-fil-A cow. First of all, I just want to thank the city for their partnership, continued partnership with our 5K. Dr. Fravel and Mrs. Fravel for the Kids Fun Run and all the community participants. It was our 7th annual fun run this year. This coming year will be our 8th annual. It's on November 3rd, so start practicing, get those tennis shoes out, and we want you to come down. We just appreciate everything that the city does to help us make this such a big, huge success, and we're just thankful tonight that we're able to help Saving Young Hearts. Here's Martha Lopez Anderson.
Thank you, Beth. I just want to say that I'm incredibly grateful not only to Chick-fil-A for being an amazing community partner that they are and helping not only Saving Young Hearts but so many other organizations and schools in our community, and obviously the city of Ocoee. This is you know, a real pleasure to be here and to accept this generous donation to Saving Young Hearts, which we will put in very good use because we are now having to replace some of the initial AEDs that we place in the community are no longer under the manufacturer's warranty, and so they have to be replaced. So we will be doing that, and stay tuned because we hope to be announcing our next youth heart screening event, which is for children 5 to 18 years old. And for those that are you know, watching at home, just know that sudden cardiac arrest in youth, which is the focus of Saving Young Hearts, is something that can be prevented. That is one thing that I unfortunately had to learn the hard way. I lost my 10-year-old son, who appeared to be seemingly healthy when he was rollerblading in our neighborhood. And losing him, I can tell you, changed my life forever. But learning that his death could have been prevented is something that I don't know I'll ever overcome. And so my message to parents and to others that work closely with children is, please be mindful of the warning signs and symptoms of a heart condition, which you can find on our website at savingyounghearts.org. And know that these things can be prevented. How? Through early detection and by being prepared when a cardiac emergency occurs. Knowing hands-only CPR and having access to automated external defibrillators is very critical. And in schools, having a cardiac emergency response plan so that when the emergency occurs, you can very quickly and efficiently deliver the cardiac chain of survival, execute the cardiac chain of survival. So it's ARC month, so this is pretty cool. So anyhow, again, you can go to savingyounghearts.org. There's a lot of information. And again, thank you so much to the City of Ocoee, to Chick-fil-A, and also to Dr. Fravel's office for, again, another amazing community partner who has does amazing things for our kids. And so thank you all.
Just one more quick thing. I want to thank all the community partners who helped partner with us that day for the 5K. Can't do it without them. And if you don't know about Saving Young Hearts, please do Google them. Find out about what they do in our community. We're blessed to have been with them since day one, and we're just blessed that we can continue to help them. We will have a new benefactor this year for the 5K. We do put the application online at the City of Ocoee. It will also be on the Chick-fil-A website. If you're a local nonprofit, I believe 501(c) with an Ocoee address, you can apply to be a benefactor. So that process will be up, should be March, probably by March 15th. It should be out there. If you have any questions, feel free to call me at Chick-fil-A in Ocoee or stop by. Again, thank you. We love our community, and we love that we are able to partner with so many worthy causes.
Come on down and take a picture. Everybody come down front. Take a picture here. Not that you've ever had a picture, have you, Beth? We'd like to thank Dr. Rebels for all their efforts and help with our city and with the wrong place. With Chick-fil-A. Chick-fil-A is one of the better helpers we have in our city, and we really appreciate their time and efforts they put in. All right. Now we have presentation by Deputy Chief Pasilla and the Citizens Advisory Council for Ocoee Police Department.
So I'd first like to introduce you to Community Service Aide Mark Sokowski. Mark, if you would come down and join us with your wife. I'm going to tell you a few things about him while he's coming down. He's originally from Duluth, Minnesota. He went to the police academy in Minnesota for law enforcement and was a police officer in the village of Lake. I'm never going to say this name right. What he said. Nebagamon in Wisconsin. He then moved to sunnier South Florida, and he was where he was previously employed in the Isleworth community working in security services. In 2007, he was hired as a community service aide, and he quickly moved in the department's evidence section and has worked in evidence as well as been a community service aide for the last 11 years. Mark is married to his wife, Jillian, for 23 years, who doesn't want to join us up front. They have three children, Bradley, who is also employed in our city's Parks and Rec department, their son Keegan, who is currently serving in the Marine Corps, and a daughter Madison, who is attending Seminole State College working towards a degree in criminal justice.
Okay, and I'm Victoria Laney with the Citizen Advisory Council for the Ocoee Police Department, and this is one of our newer members. She hasn't gotten the shirt yet, but she has the heart already. you want to introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Penny Christian, and I would just like to say congratulations on behalf of all those that we had the honor to read and to vote for.
Okay, and so it's always a difficult task, but when we looked at it, we chose Mark Sulkowski as Civilian of the Year because he was recognized for his hard work as a community service aide. This year, he took on the additional task, as you heard, of being the agency evidence technician. And in that role, he went above and beyond assisting the public and officers while still performing his duties as a community service aide, whether as a school crossing guard, reviewing red light cameras, or conducting child seat safety inspections. He embraced providing support to staff and the general public, all while displaying a positive and professional image of the police department. So we congratulate CSA Mark Sulkowski as Civilian of the Year for 2017.
So our next award is for our Volunteer of the Year Award, and this year it goes to our chaplain group. So what I'd like to do is call our chaplains down. So we have Chaplain David Hartberger, who has been serving the Ocoee Church of Christ since 2001. Chaplain Margaret Marquez, who's been serving since 2012, and she's with the Ocoee Christian Church. Chaplain Keith Tower, who's been serving since 2010, and he's with High Point Church in Ocoee. Chaplain Gary Howell, who's been serving since 2016, who comes to us from Glad Tidings Church. And Chaplain Dr. Gloria Stevens, serving since 2016, who's from Pleasant View Baptist Church. So just a little bit of work about our chaplain program. It was founded in 1995, and they've been active over the last few years and participate in many of our community events. This year, they participated in the Remembrance Around the Pole. They did great work on the project at Spring Lake Elementary, the Blue Jay Way. And they also host our crossing guards training before the school year starts. So they're part of that.
Okay, and we want to again congratulate the Volunteers of the Year 2017, the Ocoee Police Department Chaplain Unit, and also Dennis Murray was nominated too. It's always hard to pick, and this is actually their second year being awarded this honor, but we just could not overlook the incredible things they did. The second annual Remembrance Around the Flagpole event did kick off the police week in May, and it was attended by local law enforcement officers, chiefs, and other local chaplains, and members of the public and the CACOPD. That we were especially impressed by a major project, Operation Blue Jay Way, and Serve Our City. All the chaplains, with the help of their congregations, took different roles in the project. They got contractors, they had employees from the local hardware store, and they got all the materials needed to fix up the trail where the students of Spring Lake Elementary walked to school. And it used to be all graffiti and trash and broken fences. Now it's beautiful. They removed the trash, recovered the graffiti, repaired the broken sections of the fences, and they painted the trail side of the fences. Also this year, as mentioned, they provided breakfast for school crossing guards during their annual training at the beginning of the school year. The chaplains wanted to provide them with words of encouragement, breakfast, and to pray for a safe school year, which certainly we need prayers for that. And so we proudly present to you the Volunteers of the Year 2017, the Ocoee Police Department Chaplain Unit.
Still have some to go.
Good to see you too. So next, I'd like to introduce you to Officer Joshua Tolliver. Joshua, if you would join us. And if you would bring your mom and your dad and your sister with you. So Joshua grew up in Mount Dora, Florida. However, he spent much time growing up in the Apopka area. He attended Apopka High School and graduated in 2014. In 2015, he decided that he wanted to join the police academy and serve his community, as his brother does with the Orlando Fire Department. And his sister will soon serve as a nurse in our community. Officer Tolliver attended the Seminole State Police Academy and graduated in March of 2016, and he has served the Ocoee Police Department since June of 2016. He also has his pastor here with him from his local church in Apopka.
Okay, very good. Officer Tolliver was nominated for his dogged determination, but after seeing the Chick-fil-A cow, I think we should call it cow-like determination, because that's really an impressive animal. So anyway, but he had dogged determination and overall hard work. During the last quarter of 2017, Officer Tolliver made 17 arrests and took 44 reports. Most of those were for narcotics violations. They were generated because he was so good at gathering intelligence on known persons of interest. He conducted surveillance and he made effective traffic stops. Officer Tolliver is highly respected by his peers and senior officers on his squad. He was awarded the Officer of the Fourth Quarter Award for his efforts to improve the quality of life, preserve order, and provide excellence in police service. Let's all congratulate him.
So our next award goes to someone who needs no introduction, but I'm going to introduce her anyway. Detective Michelle Grogan, if you would join us, and Commissioner, may I ask that you join us as well? Children? Harrison, Isabel, and Amanda? So Detective Grogan, as you can tell by her accent, is originally from Brockton, Massachusetts, and she is married to City of Coocoee Commissioner John Grogan. They relocated in Florida in 1998. Michelle was previously employed as a school teacher, and she and Commissioner Grogan attended the Citizens Police Academy, and she was recruited to become a police officer by our then Sergeant Steve McCosker. She began the police academy in 2002 and joined the Ocoee Police Department in 2003 as a police officer. Michelle has worked as a patrol officer, a detective, a school resource officer, and she's still currently assigned as a detective unit, the detective in the persons unit. Detective Grogan has participated in the Central Florida Domestic Task Force, the Central Florida Human Trafficking Task Force, the Sex Offender Task Force. She's a member of the CART team and of the TRIAD group.
Yes, Detective Grogan was selected. It's always very hard to do Officer of the Year. All of the nominations are hard to pick. They're all so good. And we had other officers nominated, Officer Birdsong, Hernandez, Brian Harris, and Joshua Tolliver. But she was nominated for Officer of the Year for her excellent detective work and concern for victims of domestic abuse in the community. She was also nominated as Officer of the Quarter for the first and third quarters of 2017, and she received Officer of the Third Quarter from the CACOPD. The nominations describe her as a great resource, someone who's always willing to listen, and one who completes tasks without cutting corners and with nothing less than her best effort. The second nomination focused on her efforts in handling a case of aggravated domestic violence battery. The suspect was holding a victim and a child against their will. Detective Grogan was able to talk to the suspect for over an hour, and in an effort to keep him calm and to persuade him to release the woman and her child, which he did. Her actions were described as those of someone who went above and beyond the call of duty and personified what citizens want and expect from their Ocoee police officers. So we're very proud to congratulate Detective Michelle Grogan as your 2017 Officer of the Year. Congratulations. No hugs, no kisses. Later. Okay. Our last presentation of the evening is for Officer David Ogletree. Officer Ogletree is a graduate of Florida State University
where he graduated as an ACC indoor track and field champion, and yes, he has the ring to prove it. He attended the Pat Thomas Law Enforcement Academy through the Tallahassee Community College. Dave has worked in several areas of the agency to include patrol, detectives, narcotics agent, and currently serves as our school resource officer at our Ocoee Middle School. He's been serving our community since 2006. He's married to Claire, and he's the proud parent of two children, a girl named Charlotte and a boy named William, who's 6 months old, so Claire couldn't be here tonight because she's taking care of that six-year-old newman.
Okay, the City of Ocoee Police Department Civic Crisis Intervention Team Officer of the Year 2017 is presented to Officer David Ogletree in recognition of your dedication and professionalism. The department and your peers have recognized you as the Ocoee Police Department's Crisis Intervention Team Officer of the Year. Your dedication, actions, and a job well done have not gone unnoticed.
Mayor, thank you. I want to thank all the officers for all they do and all the sacrifices that them and their families make to serve this city. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank great you. Staff. Thank you. All right. We're presentation by SNME Lakefront Park final concept plan.
From SNME, we have Bruce Hall, and I'm Al Butler, Director of Support Services. Bruce?
Good evening. I'm very pleased to be here to present this to you tonight. It's been a lot of work over a series of time, a lot of variations, but I think we've come up with a really great community park for Ocoee. Look forward to presenting and walking you through it this evening. So what we have here is the overall concept for orientation. North is to the left. We have Blueford along the bottom of the graphic, Lakeshore Drive along the top of the graphic, and the edge to the right we have McKee Street. So basically, more or less the boundaries of the project area. At the center of the project is the Lakeshore Center, and then and really the concept here was to introduce as much green space into the park as we possibly could, focusing on some of the events that the community has along the waterfront, the Founders Day, and just have a very flexible green space throughout the park area. We have so green spaces in what we call kind of the lower commons down in this area, more of the upper commons that gets into the City Hall proposed complex in this area, and some activity spaces, and then back in this area along Blueford at the north end of the site, a lot of the parking areas. So we're slowly progressing with parking a little bit further away from the public space, the waterfront, where it opens up the space for the entire community. These are some of the many design elements that are within the project, and we'll go through each one of them. But key to the project really are the City Hall complex, accommodating the Lakeshore expansion that's under design right now, adding additional restrooms to accommodate day-to-day uses, weekend uses, and activities. And we're looking to accommodate the multiple stages, including the primary event stage, boardwalks, the existing boat ramp, improved wedding garden and facilities associated with the Lakeshore Center, and really just a lot of flexible spaces for all the residents. This area here is really just focusing in on the Lakeshore Center area. We're looking to accent the existing parking lot that's on the south side of the Lakeshore Center with a connection into a larger new parking area just to the north of the McGuire House, expanding some of the parking over here in this area that's to the west of the existing City Hall that's right in this location. We're also showing on the southern boundary, Oakland Avenue, a redesigned and reconstructed Oakland Avenue that has the flexibility to not only accommodate a lot of parking, but also be shut down for special events that may occur within the park. This is getting over into the City Hall area. We're showing right now a conceptual footprint for the City Hall building. There's still a lot of effort that needs to go into what the actual footprint would look like, but the idea is that it would focus on the corner of Oakland Avenue coming in, kind of anchor that corner, but on the other side have another iconic architectural element that would hold the corner of McKee and Bluford, so that really the government center City Hall complex is along this edge of Bluford in a block-to-block configuration. On the back side, we have parking back in this area, and then over in this area would be a splash pad with pavilions around it. We have restroom buildings and shelter, picnic area, and then a flexible event plaza in this area that can actually spill out into the upper commons lawn area. So there's a lot of flexibility there for events of varying sizes, and naturally the splash pad area can always go dry, and we can have an event over on that area as well. We're looking to kind of connect Oakland and the parking lot here on occasions if we need to with a minor drive through here, but for the most part it'll be a sidewalk that'll just link the City Hall complex back over here to the Lakeshore Center.
And we have removable bollards at both ends, yes, so that you could open that up if you needed to.
And then this small area here would be an opportunity where it could be a small memorial garden of some sort. The memorials could be repositioned over there. They're over in this area roughly now at the Lakeshore Center, and we could possibly make it one of the three icon elements in that location. Here's some perspectives that we've come up on for the City Hall area, and mostly identifying not so much the architecture, but how it would blend and integrate into the park. This is a view more or less from the center of the intersection at McKee and Bluford. We have the City Hall complex or building here. The center entrance would be over here. This would, we're looking for an architectural element that would function as a trailhead and also hold this corner with some massing. So we looked at clock tower type element, shade structure, and maintaining the architectural style that might evolve in the City Hall design exercise. And this is just getting a little higher up in the air. Again, this is McKee here, Bluford here, on-street parking through here, angled parking, which we also are showing over here on Bluford. So we're starting to see this trailhead plaza over here, and then a plaza over here on the Oakland entrance side. And this is the view from Oakland, the new configured Oakland that comes into the park and back to the Lakeshore Center. This would be not designed, it's just a massing right now, but something that would be a gateway element that would flank the north side of the entrance to acknowledge the park there, and then over on the other side, we would have the City Hall, maybe a flag court right in this area. And in the schemes, the trail connection on over towards the West Orange Trail might come along here, cross in this area, and then continue on into the park, or continue on over to the trailhead that's over on that area. And really, the trailhead design and concept is a place for people to drive to and get onto the trail. It has the amenities for the bike repairs, and actually kind of go back into that. You can park here, you'll park your car here and walk the bike on over. Going back to here, a lot of the destinations will really be the waterfront, and that's quite a bit of what will draw people into the park from the trail as a route. This gives you a little bit more of a bird's eye perspective of it. Really, in all these concepts, you're seeing a lot of trees. We're trying to maintain the character of a heavily treed green space, but it has a lot of open areas too that are flexible and provide a lot of opportunities for uses. A little higher up, again, Oakland coming and turning into the Lakeshore Center, and then that can loop back around here. All these streets, the way we've configured it, everything can be closed down for a temporary event, so you have multiple venues, but we want to maintain the connections and operations throughout. So we might have removable bollards or something out here at the entrance to Oakland if there's a street fair going on here. But you could still have maybe a connection back here behind City Hall. And this is another view looking towards the northwest. We have the City Hall building, the trailhead here, and this is McKee. This might be the splash pad area, the restroom and pavilion over here, and then into smaller group pavilions on either side of the splash pad.
Those are shade structures for the parents watching the kids.
Yeah. And then this is a view from the north end. This is Oakland here. Lakeshore Center parking is here. Splash pad over on this side on the left. And then this would be the Memorial Garden that I mentioned previously. And here's the outdoor plaza that can expand out into this lawn area here. So getting into a little bit more detail, this is a good portion of the lower commons. So the boat ramp stays here. We have boat parking and the ability to turn around. There will be other opportunities with parallel on-street parking for the boats and other locations.
Right, we're removing the large parking area that's on the west side of Lakeshore Drive through here. We're removing those small tree planters. We would still be preserving the electrical connections for you to utilize this as a venue for with either the food trucks or tents, different merchants of that type. But we're trying to provide a larger open area for events in the grass space there of the city commons by cutting Oakland so that we would maintain connectivity for Oakland and Lakewood and the residential properties adjacent to that. But we would take out a section of Oakland to the west that would allow us continuity across that now roadway intersection so that we can have easier flow within the site as well as larger events while preserving the cross connections that we are establishing between the other spaces. So we're trying to provide not only individual spaces for events of various sizes, but also cross connections that allow multiple things to be happening at one time without necessarily interfering with each other. So with the nature of this setup, you could continue to operate your basic services, such as the trailhead and the splash pad, while having special events in the other space that you wouldn't have to do without those, so people could rely on the fact that when they bring their kids, it's going to be open, regardless of whatever special events you might have.
So in a little bit more detail, we would look to place the Founders Day stage in here, so it's more centralized on the large, gently sloping lawn. It's pretty smooth out there, and it really sets it up well for, as you know, for events. We have opportunities up here, like in this corner where Oakland turns into Lakeshore Center, to have a smaller stage and have a smaller venue right in this area. You might notice right in this stretch, this is where the drive goes around the side of the Lakeshore Center. I believe the restroom buildings are in this area. This is now more of a pedestrian promenade. So we're looking at a nice 10-12-foot walkway that cycles throughout the park. Down by the waterfront, we've looked at a boardwalk that comes out along here, large shade structure, opportunity to for folks to dock anywhere along here that are out on the lake or launching out of the ramp. We also have the ability to tie up canoes, kayaks, and really just paddle boards and do rentals out of a restroom building over in this area that would also be shelled out if a concession vendor was interested in coming out there. More pavilions, but this becomes a little plaza here. These are the existing structures. And really the idea is to use this linear boardwalk as a nice strolling activity in the evening, get out close to the water. It also will help to be designed in such a manner to help dissipate some of the wave action. So we'll lose a lot of the erosion that occurs along the shoreline. It'll give us an opportunity to restore some of that shoreline as well. Over on the northernmost side, this is where City Hall is presently. We're looking at three large group pavilions, another opportunity for a small venue event where a stage could be placed out here. And what we have to help make up the grade is a low retaining wall here, so we'd have the ability for folks to sit in chairs up above, sit on the wall, and then they could sit below in the lawn there. And then just a small entry plaza in this area with some stair step seating walls. Over here, we get into, and this is really still is to be determined, but the idea is that this is a stormwater basin that is going to treat a lot of the stormwater that drains from elsewhere on the park and comes into this area. And then getting into phasing, we're looking at right now the first phase being this lower commons area, modifications to the parking, improvements along the lakeshore. It'll encompass parking revisions, Oakland no longer continuing through here but turning into the lakeshore center. New parking area here where a lot of this is turf parking to the west of the Lakeshore Center, some parking expansion in this area. We talked about the existing garden getting positioned in this area, but we can also look at relocating that elsewhere on the site if we'd like to. That would also include phase one, a wedding garden in this area just off of the McGuire House, which works out really well with the event center. And then we get into phase two, which includes the City Hall parking lot, the splash pad, and event plaza out here. And then phase three would be over here. Basically, it's with City Hall getting repositioned in phase two, we now have this area opened up to take down the existing City Hall and start to build some park amenities there. Phase three would also include the boardwalk out along the waterfront. And that's it? Sure.
Yeah, what we're trying to do with phase one is have construction concurrent with the improvements to the Lakeshore Center so that by the time that project's finished, we'll have the parking and the adjacent venues ready to go, because we don't want to be really having a lot of construction going on next to the Lakeshore Center after it's reopened in early 2019. So we would be trying to work on design and build of the basic phase one improvements during the spring, and then the construction would be during the summer and the fall. Hope that all that be finished up in time for Founders Day, along with the exterior portions of the expanded Lakeshore Center. Then phase two would be concurrent with the construction of City Hall, so that we're trying to only disturb, you might say, one portion of the park at a time, so that we still have areas for people to enjoy and utilize the space. And then phase three, that's really sort of in the future. We're not going to do the design on phase three. We're going to go ahead and do phase one and phase two design up front because those pieces fit together so closely. But phase three, we're going to let the park sort of age a little bit and see what services and facilities people are really utilizing, and that'll help us better target the types of improvements that we want in phase three. It also gives us time for the stormwater project, the park that's on the west side of Bluford to be completed, and this will integrate with that on the stormwater treatment on the north side of the property. Yes, sir.
One comment. If you would take this piece here and put those phases down under here, put them on there.
Right.
Have them listed on this also.
Okay.
It would be a big, big help.
Okay.
All right. And then if anybody comes in, won't see what we're doing, you can give them that, and it shows when the phases will be. Very anybody well. Else have any comments?
Oh,
you done?
Yes, sir.
I think it's great. Looks great.
I think Mr. Manacki wants you.
I have a question, but it's kind of on the side of it.
Come on up, Mr. Manacki.
Where are we going to meet in the commission meeting? What building?
City Hall. The new City Hall, the relocated City Hall. The relocated City Hall.
Where's that at?
It's.
It's going to be over there, okay. Now that's on the other side of Bluford or what?
It is across Oakland from the Withers McGuire House. It's currently a vacant lot.
Oh, okay.
Beside Betty J's.
Right, it's in between the florist, you know, on McKee in Bluford and Withers McGuire House. There's a vacant lot across there.
Oh,
that's
okay.
Where the new City Hall is going to go.
I've been over there, yeah. Okay, thank you.
We'll have you a special recliner.
Yes.
We're going to have you a special recliner.
It's interesting.
Yeah.
I have a question. I'm so impressed with this. I just have a question on kind of the side of it, and I was going to bring it up later, but are we going to do anything with Lakeshore Drive when you're going out? Because I've had an issue with some folks telling me that Lakeshore going out to Silver Star is a real problem, especially if you're coming west on
coming
Silver
in,
Star.
Yes, turning yeah. Turning left off of Silver Star is a bit of an issue.
It is. So is this going to, okay, I'm going, we're going west and turning in at that point of Lakeshore, you know what I'm talking about, around the curve.
We're hoping actually to address that as part of the Silver Star project that is currently underway with Metro Plan Orlando and Florida DOT. You may recall a couple of years ago, we applied for a CDBG grant to build a sidewalk that filled in that gap. We were just a handful of poor people short of being able to get that money. So what we were planning to do would be to build that as part of that project. So that's why it's not shown here, but it would start there at Lakewood and go around to Silver Star and then tie in to whatever sidewalk that they're providing as part of the Silver Star.
Well, it's not the sidewalk. I'm talking about, do we have any thoughts of making this one way?
Well, when you put, because there's no right-of-way for Lakeshore Drive, between this park and Silver Star Road, we would have to put the sidewalk in the street. That would make the street narrower, and so it would be a one-way headed towards Silver Star Road. You wouldn't have a left turn onto Lakeshore Drive from Silver Star in that curve. Instead, you'd need to make the left turn at Lakewood, which is the next intersection.
Yep.
That's a safer place anyway. So you'd still maintain two-way traffic on Lakeshore Drive, such as for the school traffic, but it would be sort of a divided median. You could come out from Lakeshore Drive onto Silver Star Road.
But you can't come in.
But you wouldn't be able to come back in that way.
But we're going to address that at the Metro with the Metro plan?
Right, that's part of the Silver Star
project. Okay, just wanted to, because
we need a place to go once we get up there.
Right, okay.
That whole problem with Robert's Rise was put in there where they put it in at, that curve, when people bought those places. They got a problem there because of the curve. I mean, that's not our city road. Silver Star is not ours.
Yeah, that reverse curve is a bit of a problem, not
yeah.
only for traffic,
for
but for
sides.
Pedestrians too, bicycles.
Yeah.
Well, and that's why, again, I didn't know if we were looking at that one way now or we're looking, as you say, we're going to look at it when the Metro plan, the Silver Star issue comes in.
We could do that independently, if you will, but we're really hoping to make it part of that project so that the sidewalk continuity is provided when we get up there to the Silver Star Road.
Okay, thank you. That's because that is an issue.
Yes.
But otherwise, I'm impressed.
Well, if we can get your consensus approval to go forward with this plan, what we'll do next is we'll ask the consultants for a price proposal to develop the construction documents, and then we'll bring that to you as a contract proposal in the next meeting or two.
And once again, I'd like to get the copies of the phases. I'd like to have a copy
right.
of that. Any consensus for everything okay?
Well, I like it.
Yep. All right.
All right, thank you. We'll of course, bring back when we do the individual projects, we'll show you what those details are prior to the construction.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right. Comments from citizens and public. Anybody in this audience that has nothing on the agenda would love to make a comment. Now's the time. If it's not on the agenda. All right, we'll close it and bring it up to staff reports.
Thank you, Mayor. Just one small item this evening. You have the item in front of you. It just missed the close of the agenda cycle this week, but it's the approval to trade in a non-working thermal camera for credit on a new purchase in the fire department, and that does require commission approval, so I'd ask for your approval on that.
So they're going to give us money we ain't got to pay any?
It's $500.
Hey. Yeah. Do I hear a motion?
Motion to approve.
Second?
Second.
Motion made and seconded. Motion made by Commissioner Keller, seconded by Commissioner Firstner. Any other comments? Let's vote. We'll take the check.
And thank you. That's all I have.
Okay. All right. Commissioner's announcements. Commissioner Grogan.
I have none at this time. Thank you.
Commissioner Wilson.
Nothing at this time. Thank you.
Commissioner Firstner.
Not at this time.
Commissioner Keller.
None at this time.
All right. Announcements. The city's general municipal election for commissioners district 2 and 4 and for voting on referendum ballot questions regarding changes to the city's charter will be held on Tuesday, March the 13th. To view sample ballots and get clarification and understanding of the charter amendment questions, please visit the elections page on the city's website. The Woman's Club will host their political forum on Monday, February 26th at 6:30 p.m. here in Ocoee City Hall, Commission Chambers. The public is invited to meet and hear the candidates for City Commission Districts 2 and 4. Those attending will have the opportunity to submit written questions for the candidates. The forum will be televised on Spectrum, channel 493, at which time questions from residents may be called in during the broadcast at 407-554-7118 or emailed to citizens@ocoee.org. The 16th annual Best Fest will be held on Thursday, March the 8th from 5 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. right here at Bill Breeze Park. Come out and indulge in West Orange County's largest food tasting and business expo. What you going to do the spring thing at the end?
Yeah, I thought I mentioned that at the end.
All right, consent agenda.
Motion to approve.
Before we start, I'm going to pull item 6 and we'll discuss it. Let's go ahead and have approval for rest. I'm going to pull 6. Nice. I need a motion for the other
motion
items.
To approve all but item 6 on the consent agenda.
Your second?
Second.
Motion made by Commissioner Keller to do the consent agenda without item 6, second by Commissioner Grogan. No more comments. Let's vote. All right. Joyce is covered our purchasing agent. I pulled item 6. We had discussed this before about doing the, and when we did the Boys Club deal, we were going to let them have the bus, about donating the old bus to them to use for our kids back and forth. So when this thing go into the auction, which it won't be worth a lot of money, we're going to let them take it and work on it and fix it up. So I just want to get a, do we need a motion on it, Rob? Where'd he go?
I'm sorry. Go ahead. Tell me the boys
and girls club. Remember, we voted to give them money.
And
we told them we'd give them the bus to work towards the. They can do the repairs and all that on it.
For the record, it's item 133. It's listed as a Bluebird bus, but it's actually a Thomas bus. So I wanted just to put
it's
that
on
there. It's a Thomas make.
Thomas.
Okay.
Yeah, Mayor, I think what you need to do is get a motion to remove that from the surplus list first of all, and we can take it off the surplus, and then a motion to do with what you want to do with the bus.
I need a motion to remove it from the auction surplus list.
Motion to remove the Thomas bus from the surplus list.
Second, please.
Second.
Motion made by Commissioner Grogan, to remove it from the surplus property list, seconded by Commissioner Firstner. Let's vote. All right, now we need a motion to turn it over to the Boys and Girls Club in West Orange County.
Okay, motion to donate the bus to the Boys and Girls Club.
West As Orange is.
County. As is.
Second. As is, second. As is.
Motion made by Commissioner Grogan, seconded by Commissioner Wilson, right?
That's fine.
All right. Yep. Any more comments? All right, let's vote. All right, thank you.
I like the as is.
All right.
Motion to approve the rest of item six.
Because we did remove it, didn't we? Yeah.
Second.
Okay.
Well, we removed one item, but we still have to.
Yeah,
right, we still
We got all the rest of the item.
Yeah, so we still have to approve that.
Motion by Commissioner Keller. Do I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Keller. Motion seconded by Commissioner Grogan. Any more comments? If not, let's vote. Carried. Thank you. All right. Going to public hearing, item seven, comprehensive plan amendment, capital improvement element. Planner Rumor.
Yes, we do have a reading of the ordinance with this.
This is an ordinance of the City of Ocoee, Florida, amending the Ocoee Comprehensive Plan as adopted in 1991, as amended, in order to comply with Section 163. 0.3177 Florida statutes amending the capital improvements element of the comprehensive plan, providing for severability, providing an effective date.
All right, I'm going to open it up for the public hearing. Anybody have any in the public have any comments to item seven, comprehensive plan amendment, capital improvement element update? No comments. We'll close the public hearing, bring it back to the dais. Any comments from commissioners? Motion. Your motion?
Motion.
Second.
Make it.
I'll make a motion.
All right, Commissioner Wilson made the motion, seconded by Commissioner Keller. Any more comments? If not, let's vote. Motion carries unanimously. Thank you. All right. We're going to go to first reading of ordinance item eight, and I think you have some. Let's see. For the language for the official municipal seal of the city and adopt a new language for official city logos.
This is an ordinance of the City of Ocoee, Florida, creating Article 4 of Chapter 1 of the Code of Ordinances of the City of Ocoee relating to official city seals and logos, repealing Section 1-11.1 of the city of the Code of Ordinances of the City of Ocoee relating to the city seal, providing for enforcement, providing for severability, providing for codification, and providing an effective date.
All right, this will be, the second reading will be on regular schedule March the 6th, 2018 at 6:15, is when we'll have the second reading. All right, go down to item nine, second reading of ordinances for Inspiration Plan Unit Development, PUD, annexation and rezoning to PUD and PUD Land Use Plan, Project AX087164 and RZ170805. City Planner Plum Rumor.
Yes, sir. Commission, we are Honorable Mayor and Commission. This item is being continued to a date certain, and that date is the next commission meeting, March 6, 2018. The item had to go before the school board before it came back to the city commission, and they do have a definitive date of February 24th, so we will not have to advertise by continuing it tonight to a date certain, which is under the public hearing agenda on the next commission meeting of March 6th.
So we need a motion to continue item 9 to March 6th.
So moved.
Motion made by Commissioner Keller. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Grogan. All right, no more. Let's vote. Motion carries unanimously. All right, let's go to item 10. Second reading of ordinance amending section 512 of the city code governing absentee voting to designate such absentee voting as vote by mail as a consistent recent changes to election statute.
This is an ordinance of the City of Ocoee, Florida, amending section 5-12 of the city code governing absentee voting vote by mail as is consistent with recent changes to the election statutes providing for codification, conflict, severability, and an effective date.
Do you have a report on this, Mel?
Well,
City Clerk?
The staff is just recommending adoption of the ordinance.
All right. All right, I'm going to open it to the public. Anybody in the public have any comments pertaining to the absentee vote and to designate such absentee voting as vote by mail? Nobody has anything, so we'll bring it back to the dais and have a motion to approve.
I make a motion to approve the ordinance.
Seconded by Commissioner Keller. Motion made by Commissioner Firstner, seconded by Commissioner Keller. Any more comments? If not, let's vote. All right, regular agenda, item 11, general election canvassing board. Appointment to the canvassing board members. You need to talk on that, Melody.
This item is a two-part staff report. There's the election, or I'm sorry, appointment of the canvassing board, which would be which we had discussed at the last meeting, would be the mayor, Commissioner Grogan, and Commissioner Firstner that would be providing us with names for appointment. So that's what we're going
to... So we're supposed to name...
We need three citizens.
Three of us that's not in the election have to name three people.
That's correct.
All righty. Commissioner Grogan?
I passed mine in, and it would be Cheryl Lynn Moore from District 1.
All right, I've got Jeremy Bellis. I'll have to get his district. Jeremy Bellis. Commissioner Firstman.
Miss Victoria Laney.
All right.
Okay, and if you just want to provide me with the information, I'll contact all the members and brief them on what will be going on with.
All right.
The second part of the of my staff report is just allowing approval for the supervisor of elections to open any unquestionable vote by mail ballots on election day, just earlier before the canvassing board gets there, just so that they can run them through the tabulator, and it'll just make for the meeting to be quicker as far as canvassing the ballots. We'll just need a motion for that.
Need a motion?
Motion to approve.
There a second?
Second.
Motion made by Commissioner Grogan, seconded by Commissioner Firstner. Any more comments? If not, let's vote. All right. Let's see. That's it, right? Mm-hmm. Staff action items. Any more, Rob?
No, sir. I don't have anything.
All right. I'm Commissioner Keller. Any comments?
No comments. Thank you, Mayor.
Commissioner Firstman.
Tomorrow, Police Department is going to be hosting Coffee with the Cop at Franco's. It'll be from 4 p.m. till 6 p.m. And also, the Little League Parade is coming up this Saturday, March 3rd, at 8 a.m.
Two Saturdays.
It'll be at 8 p.m. 8 a.m. from City Hall to Central Park. We'll come out if you're free that day.
All right. Commissioner Wilson?
Yes, I have a few questions. I guess I want to go back and ask the commission. When I noticed that we were doing the surplus and remove the bus, I don't know if anyone else got a request from one of our residents, Mr. Finger, regarding the school looking for, with their farming program, one of the surplus vehicles, a truck. I'm trying to find the email, but I guess I'm having problems with my internet.
I didn't get it.
He sent it to me, and I don't know if that's something that the commission, would be a Coe High School. We've never done it before. I don't know what the consensus is. I wanted to bring it up. I guess I know it's a little late after we voted on this, but I thought bringing it up now. I don't know what the consensus is. I'd have to find the email, but regarding a truck for them to haul animals and it was one of our surplus vehicles they were interested in. I don't know, we've never done it before, and I just don't know what the consensus of the commission, if they even would consider it. Bringing it out there.
I wouldn't have a problem with it, but I think one of the problems is dealing with the county right now. We're going to have to get permission from them to let us.
The school?
The school to do it, because we had some problems with something else with them.
The commission donated the bus. The bus was in good operating order, and as is, can probably be used. Most of the trucks that are out, pickup trucks that we have surplus, are going to need to be towed off because they have, they're shot. It's not just because of age, it's because they've mechanically broken down, and we're waiting on replacements to come in the budget. I don't know of anything that they would want donated at this point.
Okay, I think that answers it, thank you. I just thought, you know, again, I wasn't aware of the condition of the vehicles, but thank you.
Yeah, there's nothing I'd want to
recommend. Adage, bring your rope.
Well, and maybe they can come back at another time if there's anything that comes available, but thank you, that does answer that. Okay, next question is, and I don't know if the police or who it should address to, over on Cumberland Avenue, it seems like when you detour one group and you create one problem, you just now solve the problem, then you create another problem. I guess we have a problem over on Cumberland Avenue where people are traveling that road and at higher speeds and using it as a cut-through street.
That would be me.
Which Cumberland Road you talking about?
Cumberland Avenue. We're talking over behind, off of Blueford, and I'm sorry, off of McKee, all the way down to
Ohio.
Ohio. Possibly.
Okay. Other than enforcement, that's a brick road on part of it. It's nothing that, I mean, it's almost traffic calming in itself with the dips and just the ambiance of an old brick road. I'm not sure that people are speeding so much, just as much as I know there's a lot more traffic than there was just because of people using it as a detour, even though that's not where we're directing people.
No, I know we're not, but they find the lesser of, you know, with traffic, lesser of two evils.
I'm not sure if there's an enforcement item with that or not. I know.
I guess there's children, probably what happened is there's probably children playing out there that haven't had the traffic, you know, on the side of the street, and there's really not too much of a sidewalk over there either. So.
Yeah, there's no sidewalk, and there's a couple stop signs that they're failing to pay attention to. So I think each of the areas we try to get together with Steve and get our groups together to lessen the impact, but this is going to continue as we move. So we'll try to keep up. Cumberland all the way down?
It's from Ohio to McKee. Sorry, I'm getting confused because we're under construction over there, but
yeah,
yes.
We'll look at that. I have seen more cars going that way. They're trying to beat somebody else going the other way. So
well,
we can work something out.
Thank you. I appreciate that. All right, one more thing, and I believe I'm done. Coming up on March the 10th is our 13th annual Spring Fling, which if you've been to it before, you enjoy coming again. It's a wonderful city event. It's free. There'll be hot dogs, soda, face painters. Mostly what is educational opportunities for you to learn something. There'll be door prizes, games. So please come down, enjoy yourself. Learn about your city. Learn about the other programs that may be within the city. And come and have fun. It's going to start at 10 o'clock in the morning till 3 in the afternoon. And it's just a fun day. I think we've all been there and we enjoy it. And it's an opportunity where your children can, or you can get face painting, and it's not going to cost you anything. We want you to come learn and enjoy the day. So mark your calendars for March the 10th, and we'll expect you to have a great time. Thank you.
All right. Anybody else have any more comments? If not, we will adjourn the meeting. Thank you.
Wow. Okay. Now, what was wrong with my internet?
I did.